I know that this is concrete design and it's not steel design, but since I think everybody in here is also in steel design, am I right? For the vast majority of you. Does anybody have any homework questions about this or the steel design homework? Since we're all here, we're all friends, I think. Everybody good?
No.
Okay.
On problem 2, it was
Which class?
Oh, this is concrete.
Concrete.
I was confused on like the AC.
The AC.
Like you do your guess.
Okay, so what's the size of your column? Okay, so you would just take that diameter, subtract 3 inches because there's 1.5 cover on each side. And then, so that, you know, that -3 would be your core diameter. And so pi over 4d squared times that would be your AC. So, that's fine. That's a little one. And one of the things about columns is that there is sort of a way of throwing a bunch of crap at you all at once. There's a lot of nitpicky little details. And there are a few new symbols. Like, that's one of the things with beams is that we were really, really careful with our notation. And we very, very slowly introduced, like, what is A? What is H sub F? You know, what is D prime? And then there's columns, and we throw a whole bunch of ACs and AGs and rho S mins and all this stuff at you. So I can appreciate that. Any other questions on the homework, either in here or steel? Yes?
So in steel.
In steel.
Different CV values for different sections.
Yes.
You just use the largest CV value.
Ooh, that's a great question. And the answer is no. Okay, so for those of you on YouTube who decided to tune in to listen to the concrete design lecture, you can hit pause. Okay, so here's an example. Okay, and I'm just going to keep it simple. Okay. I have a load here, and I have a load here. Now, let's ignore dead load. Like, I'm just ignoring it, okay? Would you agree that your reactions are going to look like that? So your shear diagram is going to go like up, over, down, over, down, over, up, right? So your moment diagram is going to look like this, this, and that. Make sense? Okay. So we're going to have a moment here and a moment here. So there's 3 different segments to consider. Okay. Now, let's say for the sake of discussion that LB is 10 feet for each of these. See, it's great that you're asking this because I literally just had an email question about this very thing, so I'm glad this is being asked. All right. There are 3 parameters that ultimately govern how a beam is going to perform. It's maximum moment, it's CB, and it's LB. Make sense? All right, now, LB is not like, so there's 3 segments. Which ones do we have to look at? Well, LB doesn't really matter for this example because they're all the same, right? Okay, M max also doesn't matter because M max for this segment is right here, M max for this segment is right here, and M max for this segment, they're all the same. So the big question is CB. So which segment do you consider? Now, if you have a constant bending moment here, what's CB for this segment? If it's constant. 1. Because remember the formula, it's 12.5 times M max over 2.5 mmax, 3mA, 4mB, 3mC, right? Well, if all those quantities are the same, you have 12.5 over 12.5, so it's 1, okay? Now, for this segment and this segment, it's not going to be 1, it's going to be greater than 1. So it doesn't really matter what the value is, it's just recognize that it's greater than 1. Is everybody in agreement with that? Now, I'm going to tell you it's 1.67. Okay? Now, the question is, which is the worst case scenario? Okay? Well, what does CB serve to do? CB serves to increase your beam's strength. So the worst case scenario would be to look at a segment that has the lowest CB value. See, if you look at these segments, they all have the same unbraced length, they all have the same Mmax, but this is the segment that matters because this is the one that has the lowest CB value. So you can essentially ignore these segments and just look at this one. Does that make sense? Because, think about it, when you go into your design chart, what are you going into your design chart with? You're going into it with MU over CB, right? Well, which one's going to have a larger MU over CB value? The middle segments or the end segments? The answer is the middle segment, right? Because that's going to be your largest effective moment on the section. So here's another sort of example on the side. Now, first off, let me be clear. If I throw other loads onto this, or a load here, or a load there, all these CB values are wrong because they're a function of your bending moments. Everybody okay with that? Now, let's throw another example. Let's say I have a beam that's only seeing a distributed load. Okay? But let's say that it's braced, I don't know, every 10 feet. So it's got braces all over the place. Okay? So its moment diagram is going to look like that, right? So that means every segment has a different Mmax. Okay? So now, which segment do you consider? Well, let's take a look at this end segment, right? This is its Mmax, right? And I would argue, remember, C sub B values are sort of like slopes, like how much the moment changes. So I would argue that this segment here has a low Mmax and a high CB. Whereas this segment, that's Mmax and it has a low CB. So in other words, I can totally ignore the end segments and only focus on the middle segment because the middle segment has the largest demand and the lowest gradient. Does that make sense? Now, did that make sense to everybody else that's in steel design? Because that does show up on the exam. And I almost made it a point not to discuss that in class because I wanted that question to come up. We'll see if somebody asked that.
They did.
That was good stuff. Now, if you have a problem that's, there was an example, of, what was it, like example 23? Is that the one, or is it 22? The one that had the CB calc, and it was the beam that had it was an overhanging beam, and it had all sorts of weird bending moments on it. Do y'all remember that? I think it was like example 23. What was it, 22, 23, something like that? It was a beam that was like this, and there was a support here, and then it had a distributed load, and it had a point load, and it had, you know, like a, I think it had a point load right there, and it sort of went like that. Y'all remember that beam? I don't remember which example it was, 22. 22, example 22. And so on a problem like that, it's possible that you kind of have to check all of the segments because they're all different. Okay, and so what I would probably do is, when I'm in design mode, I would design for whichever segment had the largest of these values, the MU over CBs, but then I would go back and make sure that all the other segments had adequate capacity. And so that one probably would require a bit of iteration. So. What do we think? Sound good? All right, are there any other questions? And I'll take steel design and concrete design questions.
No problem with that.
Does everybody have this, these charts? Everybody have these with them? Okay, because we are going to use those today. Let me sort of recap where we left off last time. So, last time, I think I went through the construction of a curve like this kind of quickly. So, I just want to make sure that everybody's crystal clear on where a curve like this comes from. Okay? So, we're going to go back to basic fundamental mechanics just so that you all understand. Okay? When you have a column that's being subjected to some stress, like that's some load, then its stress profile looks like this. This is like engineering 216, mechanics of deformable bodies. And that stress is P over A. Is everybody okay with that? Like that's like when you have a column or an element and you squish it, I take this marker and I squish it, the stress on that section is P over A, and it's the same stress everywhere. The stress here is the same as the stress there, and so on and so forth. Everybody okay with that? Now, when you have a segment, and you apply a bending moment to it, then its stress looks like that. I'm sorry, I need to do a better bit. Looks more like that. And that's MY over I, right? And so this might be compression over here, and this might be tension, right? And remember, concrete is a material that is very, very weak in tension, which is why we place rebar in the section of the beam that's experiencing tension, right? Basic reinforced concrete design, okay? Well, what happens when you have both bending moment and axial load at the same time? Well, when you have that, so this is having that and this. Well, what could happen is this. Let's say, for instance, that this stress equals that stress. In other words, like I'm taking this and I'm adding that. It's very possible that you get a bending stress profile that looks like this. So to give you kind of an idea, let's put some numbers. Like let's say that this is 10 KSI, let's say that this is 10 KSI, and let's say that this is 10 KSI, let's say this is minus 10 KSI. Well, on the top, 10 plus 10 is 20, right? And on the bottom, 10 minus 10 is 0. So it's possible you could get a bending stress profile where this is 0 and this is 20. And I'm just making these numbers up just to give you kind of an idea of what I'm talking about. Is everybody okay with that? The point I'm getting at is that under pure bending, so this is just bending by itself, there's no way to avoid the fact that you're going to have some tension. And concrete beams are very, very weak in tension. But if you throw a little bit of axial load on that section, you can actually eliminate the tension altogether, right? Which is why when you look at this PN curve, this point down here, this is like what, 140 some, something like that? That is the bending capacity of a beam with zero axial load. But if I start throwing axial load on there, it can actually start to handle more bending moment, which is why the curve starts to trail out this way, okay? Now there is a point right here where it really sort of ekes out its maximum flexural capacity. There's a name for that in concrete design. We call that the balance point. That's the point when the strain and the steel ends up equaling the strain and yield. That's basically where you get your maximum capacity according to bending. And then you start to really bump up the compression on the section and it starts to give out a bit. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay, so this is what's called a PM curve, and it tells you how axial load and moment interact with one another. In other words, you throw a little bit of axial load on there, it actually starts to change what the moment capacity is, and vice versa. Okay, Now, we modify this curve a bit. You know, here's our nominal curve. We then cut it off to adjust for that accidental eccentricity quantity of 0.8 for a tide column and 0.85 for a spiral column. And then we adjust it further by a phi value. But we don't really need to worry about that for our design example. I just want to show you where this goes from here on out. A lot of software programs will generate PM curves for you, and they'll do all this stuff internally. Like, you don't need to worry about calculating it on your own. What I want to do is show you how to design a beam column, and I want to show you one of the easiest methods possible, and that's using these alignment charts that are these PM curves that I've given you. So these PM curves have been generated based off of dimensionless quantities. So this Kn and this Rn value are dimensionless, and that's really, really nice because they are dimensionless parameters, you can use these for a wide variety of different sections. So it's a function of this Kn quantity and this Rn quantity. You can think of Kn as sort of related to the axial capacity and Rn relating to the moment capacity. So here's what they look like. And so to give you kind of an idea of how this is going to work, you have a series of interaction curves, and each of these curves have been drawn. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of them. Okay? Now if you look at them, it's actually pretty easy how they to understand how they generated them. Because see this 0.1, 0.02, 0.03, 0.04, 0.05, 0.06, 0.07, 0.08. Why do they start at a row of 0.01 and end at a row of 0.08? Those are the limits, right? So your reinforcement ratio has to be between 0.01 and 0.08. So the way these curves work is that there's a curve drawn for each one of those values. So the way that you use them is you compute your Kn and you compute your Rn, and you go, that's my value. And so if we're like right here, so that's sort of between, I don't know, 0.04 and 0.05, I might call that 0.043. Just linearly interpolate. And then take that value, multiply it by the gross area, boom, that's how much reinforcement you need. It's that simple. Yes?
Are we just assuming that it's always going to be 4 psi?
Yes, yes. So that's a good question. So the question was, are we always going to assume 4 psi concrete and 60 psi steel? The answer is yes. If we were not using 4 KSI concrete and 60 KSI steel, we would just use different charts. So it's not like it's any harder. It's just, instead of giving you 12 pages, I'd be giving you 120 pages with different permutations of FC prime and FY and all that. So, and they're available. I mean, it's not like there's nothing there I'm giving you that isn't readily available. But I'm giving you 4 and 60 because 4 and 60 are the most common grades of concrete and steel that we use in typical design. So. Does that sound good? Okay. So just to make sure that everybody's crystal clear on the way that these are generated, L is based off 2 layers of steel, R is based off of 3 layers of steel, L and R are for your rectangular columns, and C is for your circular columns. So just so you know what these mean, if I was asking you to refer to L460.7, L is the 2 layers of steel. The 4 and the 60 refer to the material strengths, and then the 7 refers to that gamma value. And I'll show you specifically what that means here in a second. So the design process is really, really, really simple. We just compute our factored loads. We determine the required nominal capacities, and we always assume that phi is 0.65 and for rectangular and 0.75 for circular. See, do you remember me showing you from here to here and see how there was that little nub where it's a transition region? Well, the vast majority of the chart, in this case, uses a phi value of 0.65. So if here's the chart, everything from like here up is a phi value of 0.65. So from a design perspective, it's usually very, very reasonable to assume the worst case phi value because the vast majority of the chart encompasses that. You then compute your eccentricity and your gamma value, and then finally compute Kn and Rn, and then just look up your steel. I cannot begin to stress how easy this process is. And instead of me talking, you know, about it, let's do it. Let's do an example. Okay? So column that's 14 inches by 20 inches, and I want to determine the required amount of steel, which that's another thing. By and large, beam column problems, and typically beam column problems that we're going to worry about in this course are problems that you just have to determine the reinforcement. In other words, I'm going to give you the size of the column, and you just determine the amount of reinforcement. So let's take a look at this column. So first off, the L chart, the R chart, and the C chart. Before we do anything, are we going to look at the C chart for this problem? No, why?
Because it's not circular.
There we go. So we have the L chart and the R chart. So between the L and the R, what are we going to look at? L. It's two layers of steel as opposed to three. So we're going to be looking at L charts. Okay, so that's pretty easy. Alright? I can do this on the screen if you'd like, but I cannot begin to emphasize how easy this method is. So here, let me break out the specific tool. Somewhat easy. So first off, let's factor our loads. So I figure if you have a pulse and a respiratory pattern, by now you know that if you have a dead load and a live load, you should know how to factor those loads. Am I correct? So 1.2 dead plus 1.6 live. What are we getting for each of those?
374 kips.
374 kips for the axial load. And for the moment, what are we getting? 234. Okay. Alright. What I'm going to do is, since we're going to be using moments and stresses and all that, and they're going to be combined and multiplied together and so on and so forth, I'm going to multiply this and say 2808 inch kips. But I just multiply by 12. Okay. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to compute the required capacity. And to do this, I'm going to assume that phi is 0.65. So all I'm doing is I'm dividing the phi up. You know, like phi pn has to be greater than or equal to pu. So pn has to be greater than or equal to PU over phi. Like, I'm just dividing the phi out. So PN is PU over phi, and MN is MU over phi. So somebody tell me what each of these come out to be. And they might be decimals or something like that. That's fine.
PN is 575.38.
0.38. We'll say 575.38 kips. What about ME or MN? Yes. Okay. 4320. Okay. properties of the column. Okay, so the first thing that we need is the gross area, which is just B times H, which is going to be what? Yeah, 280, 14 times 20. That's easy. Now, the next thing that we're going to need is this quantity gamma. Now, I want to visually explain what gamma is. So gamma is the distance from, or the distance between the layers of steel divided by the total height. Bless you. So how far is it between the layers of steel? 15 inches, and how high is the column? So it's 15 over 20, which is what?
0.75.
There we go. So the problem is we do not have a chart for a 0.75, but we do have an L chart for 0.7 and 0.8. So the two charts that we're going to need are that and that. Okay, the reason we're using L charts because two layers of steel, the 4 and the 60 correspond to the material strengths that we're using, and the 0.7 and the 0.8 correspond to the fact that our gamma value is between those two. So the way this will work is we're going to look up a value for 0.7, we're going to look up a value for 0.8, and then we're just going to average them. Now if this was like 0.73, you would just linearly interpolate. Y'all remember how to do that? So you'd have, so let's, for example, so you have a gamma value of 0.7 and a gamma value of 0.8. And let's say that you had a row value that you looked up of 0.021 to 0.036. And let's say you had that. Y'all know how to do that? I mean, if you've been in steel design, then we did that all the time in steel design with columns. Remember, we would have that table 4-1, and if you had a KL effective, that was like 14.7 feet, you look up 14 value and 15 value, and you interpolate. So for this example, it's going to be pretty easy. We're just going to have, you know, it's just going to be halfway between, so we'll just average it. So just wanted to throw that out there. Okay. The last thing that we have to compute is what's called an eccentricity. And an eccentricity is really easy. It's just Mn divided by Pn. And so what is that? Is it 7.51? 7.51. Okay. And so let me explain why you do that. We have a column that's going to need to have an axial capacity of 575.38 kips and a moment capacity of 4320 inch kips. Well, statics tells us that I can take these two and just sort of rewrite them as that single point load. That 575.38 kips, that's offset from the centroid. And how far? 7.51 inches. Let me erase that so you can see it. Does that make sense? Because this is statically equivalent to that. So it's just a way of simplifying our process. Sound good? Okay, so next thing that we're going to do is we're going to compute interaction properties. Oh, I can do better than that. That's fine. Now, I'm going to show you a little trick. Okay, we're going to start off with Kn. Now Kn, the way that you compute that is you say Pn on the top and you say Fc prime Ag on the bottom. Now, plug and chug, and that's 4 KSI, 280 square inches, and then 575.38 kips, and you get what? Don't clear this number out of your calculator, by the way, because I'm going to show you something. Keep that number in your calculator. Do I have a second on that? Yeah. Okay. Now, Rn, here's the formula for Rn. The formula for Rn is PnE over Fc prime AgH. Now, watch this. Does that look familiar? What is that?
Kn.
That's Kn. So all I got to do is just take Kn times E over H. So that's 0.514 times 7.51 inches over 20 inches.
Point 0.193.
Do I have a second on that?
Alright.
Okay. So we have Kn of 0.514 and an Rn of 0.193. So here's what I want you to do. Alright, and I'm going to actually do it with you here on the screen. We'll see how this is going to work. So so here's my interaction diagram, and this is diagram 0.7. I'll walk you through this one. So we're going to snip this one. Draw a straight line. I'm going to move it over here. Straight line here. Straight line like that. Okay. Now, my Kn is 0.514. So, would you agree that that's about, let's see, that's 0.4. That's 0.6, so that's 0.444852. Maybe something about like that? Is that about right? So this is 0.4, 0.6, so 0.5, a little bit higher than that, 0.514. And then 193 is, so 1.5, 1.6, 1.7, 1.8, 1.9. Is that about right? I did that right?
Yeah.
Okay, here's what I want you to do. I want you to do that on your page, and I want you to tell me what the row value is. I don't want to quite use what's on the screen because, like, I've got these really, really thick lines, and it's not super accurate. So you're going to probably do this a lot better in front of you that I am on the screen. But you should be getting a point about right there. So let's see what you get. they have a straight edge on them? If you got a wallet or a purse, you have an ID or a something in there, you have a straight edge. Take your time. Now, you are sort of eyeballing it a bit, but what I can tell you is this. So, this is the curve for a row of 0.01. This is the curve for 0.02, 0.03. So, see how we're between the 0.02 and the 0.03 curve? So, it should be row is 0.02 something. Okay, 2-2. Would you all kind of agree on that?
I think it's 2-3.
It's a troublemaker over here.
I heard a second for 2-2.
I did hear a second, so go stand in the corner. I'm kidding. No. All right, if you're okay with that, then what I want you to do now is I want you to tell me what this value is. Okay, and I'm not going to do this one with you. I want you to do this one on your own. I'm hearing an 019.
I can agree this time.
Well, now we can move forward.
It's true, too.
I'm kidding. Not really. Okay. So, is everybody all right with that? So, let me ask you this. So, we have a row value of 0.019 for this and a row value of 0.022 for this. So, now my question for you is, what is our actual row value going to be? Exactly. Just average them. We're averaging them because this is for a gamma of 0.7, this is for a gamma of 0.8, and we have a gamma of 0.75, so just take the middle. So keep in mind, what is rho? That's your reinforcement ratio. So if you take rho times the area of the column, that equals how much steel you need to put into it. So what is that? Why? Because that area is a little bit larger, And also, we do want to use an even number of bars, so we have the same number of bars up top that we do on the bottom. And if we go to our beam design aid, so we need something that's larger than 5.74, but has an even number of bars. And that's actually a pretty economical choice right there. This is actually a pretty economical choice because if we use number 10s, we'd have to use 6 bars to use an even number. We'd have to use 4 for number 11s, but that's still more steel. This is about the most economical choice that you're going to find with 6 number 9s. If we use an even number of bars, because number 8s, we're using 8 of them, we're using 10 of these, and then you're getting like 14, and that's a ridiculous number of bars. I don't know that you can even fit them in a column that's only 14 inches wide, so that's beam column design. I wish I could make that hard. I mean, that's it. I didn't want to rush that Monday. I figured take our time with it, and it's really easy. Does anybody have any questions about that? I'm hoping that last problem on the homework assignment is now really easy as a result, because I don't think it's really that much different than this. I think there might be a few more details, but it's nothing that you can't handle.
So say
you land like right beside
the lines.
Yes.
Which one
do
you go to? The large one?
Like through. Wait. You're
going
to have to show me.
Oh, I figured.
Then I would just use, well, you're not looking at these numbers, you're looking at these.
Okay.
So think this is 0.01, 0.02, 0.03, 0.04, so that would be between 0.03 and 0.04, so that's going to be, does that make sense?
Yeah.
A couple other things on this chart that might be worth mentioning that I didn't quite explicitly state. There's a lot of other things on this chart that might be worth mentioning. So, for instance, this region down here, specifically the region under that line, anything under here has a strain value larger than 0.05. So what can you tell me about the selections down here? What is the feed value? Down here. Yeah, there you go. Say it with confidence. This is the feed value of 0.9 region. Alright? A couple other things. So this region here all this, that's your transition region. Okay. In other words, your fee is between 0.65 and 0.9. One other thing worth mentioning, take a look at this. I want to look at this curve right here, this one on the inside. See its maximum, what do you think its maximum Kn value is? It's basically like 1, right? You see this K max line right there? See how it hits at 0.8? Each time where that K max value intersects with the curves, those are the cutoffs. So like if we're looking at this curve right there, the curve goes up, goes up, goes up, goes up, and that's where it cuts off. So, for some reason they don't, I know why they're just trying to plot the theoretical strength, but they indicate that that's the maximum Kx value, because if your, or your Kmax value, because if your K value gets higher than that, then you're getting off that, that accidental eccentricity line. Remember how the curves would be cut off, that cutoff curve at point A? Well, that cutoff is indicated by this Kmax indication right here. And there's a couple of other interesting places on the curve. So this is theoretically when the steel stress is zero. This is when the steel stress is 25% of yield. The steel stress is 50% of yield. The steel stress is 75% of yield. This is when the steel stress is at yield. Remember when I said that this was the balance point when the strain was at yield? You see, that's where that line is there. So yeah.
So at the beginning of the problem, when we made the assumption that B was 0.65,
yes,
he ended up in like the red region up there.
I would redo it. Yes, I would redo it with a P value of 0.9, and that might change. Like, you might have to iterate that a bit because you might be here, and then I might say, well, if I'm here, let's just average the two, and you know, keep toying with it a bit until you're about where you should be. So that's a good question. That rarely happens in most beam column design problems because the vast majority of the curve is in a 0.65 region. So that's a good question. But that's what I would do. I would recalculate your Kn and Rn based off a phi of 0.9 and then do it again. That's a good question. Sound good? Homework's due on Friday. We do exam review on Friday. So, I mean, because the homework's due, everybody needs to be here. You just got to turn it in. One other thing. So on Friday, I'm going to do the CLO surveys. So I would also like everybody here for that as well. So spread the word. That's all I got, everybody. I'll see you on Friday, our last lecture.